नमस्कार।
Honorable President, His Excellency Sri Pranab Mukherjee ji, Namaskar and a very good morning, a very good afternoon to you, sir. The officials of MHRD, the Vice Chancellors, Directors, fellow colleagues, student friends, members of the academia from the central institutions of higher learning, and the staff of the Rashtrapati Bhavan, greetings and good afternoon to all of you. The first citizen of the country certainly needs no introduction. Yet I consider it my sacred duty to record sincere appreciation and gratitude to His Excellency on behalf of the entire academic fraternity for the untiring and unparalleled interest and patronage showered by him on the entire higher education system of the country since assuming his office on 25th July 2012. As the visitor of the 114 institutions of higher learning supported by the Government of India, including IITs, NITs, ICERs, and central universities, sir, you have taken extraordinary and unprecedented effort to promote excellence and boost the standard of higher education in the country. As a part of your special drive, you invited all IIT directors and chairman board of governors to the Rashtrapati Bhavan on 22nd August 2014 for a day-long conference. Your patient hearing and valuable advices have left a deep impression in our minds about your wisdom and vision and encouraged us to rededicate ourselves to pursue excellence in engineering education. As a follow-up measure, the Honorable Human Resource Minister has instituted a special pan-IIT and IIC initiative called Impacting Research, Innovation and Technology Imprint to create a pragmatic roadmap concerning education policy and infrastructure readiness for solving the major technological challenges in the country in 10 selected domains. Sir, you met all the heads of the institutions from NITs, ICERs, and central universities in different occasions in order to promote education that, in the words of Tagore, not merely give us information, but makes our life in harmony with all existence. Sir, you invited young innovators, scientists, artists, writers to Rashtrapati Bhavan in multiple occasions for discussion, exhibition, interaction, and even instituted a scholar-in-residence program and a festival of innovation FOIN very recently. As an exemplary and pioneering effort, you have visited almost all IITs, NITs, ICERs, central universities to address at their convocation as the chief guest within these 2 years. Sir, your passion for learning from and complementing each other is amply evident from a new tradition created by you by asking the leaders from the academia to accompany you in all the presidential delegations to foreign countries to enhance academic and scientific collaboration between Indian and foreign universities. I was personally fortunate to witness your penchant for collaboration during your visit to Finland and Norway in October 2013. Sir, you have constantly urged the higher education institutions to make serious effort to feature among top 200 institutes in the world. The ministry has constituted a high-level committee, and we are making serious efforts to live up to your expectation. Sir, your relentless endeavor as the most ardent mentor of higher education to raise the level of research, innovation, education, and entrepreneurship in the country has inspired one and all and left each member of the chemical 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 of the However, I personally consider your commitment for higher education is only natural as you started your professional career as a faculty member in Birbhum way before you plunged yourself totally into selfless public life in various capacities, including your current role as the 13th President of the Republic of India. Sir, it is indeed an honor for all of us to have you amongst us today. Now, may I most humbly request His Excellency Sri Mukherjee to kindly address the academic community of the country. Sir.
Thank you, Director IIT. Very good afternoon to the Vice Chancellors, Directors, IITs, NITs, other heads of the Institutes of Higher Learning, distinguished guests, dear students, very good afternoon to all of you. I am happy to have the opportunity to interact with you at the beginning of this new academic session. I welcome all the new students to universities and other centers of higher learning, addressing you twice a year through video conference is a practice I started in January 2014 through this e-platform, which now has been upgraded to twice its capacity. It is possible for me to connect with a much larger audience from Kashmir to Kanyakumari, west to east and northeast. For that, I must thank the National Knowledge Network and the NIC teams. I speak to you today in the shadow of an irreparable loss that we have suffered in the passing away of Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam, my two illustrious predecessors, Dr. Sarvepalli Radhakrishnan, a philosopher teacher, and Dr. APJ Kalam, a scientist teacher, have greatly influenced my thinking on the education sector. When we talk of energizing the higher educational institutions, we should be guided by what Dr. Sarvepalli Radhakrishnan once observed, and I quote, "Education should be imparted with a view to the type of society that we wish to build. We are working for a modern democracy built on the values of human dignity and equality. These are only ideas. We should make them living forces." Unquote. The enduring civilization, that is India, is also a land of contradiction. It's a matter of fact that 26% of our population is illiterate. Yet, our education system has given rise to the second largest pool of scientists and engineers in the world. Even today, many villages in the country are devoid of clean drinking water, yet we churn out a larger quantity of software for US IT firms than any other country. To take this fascinating and vibrant democracy to greater heights, we need highly educated and skilled young men and women. That is the challenge before our higher education system. My dear students, as Dr. Kalam has explained in his book, Indomitable Spirit, the education system in the 21st century must be based on five components: research and inquiry, creativity and innovation, capacity to use high-end technology, entrepreneurship, and moral leadership. In the contemporary world, we are wading in a sea of information. Converting this information into knowledge and knowledge into wisdom calls for exceptional skills which we must impart in our students. They should be prepared for lifelong learning, which is easier now because of digital technology. An inquisitive mind and a research-oriented approach has to be built in our students. It is easy to be overwhelmed by the amount of information around us. But when information is networked, its power and utility increases. In today's world, management of knowledge is beyond the capacity of an individual. Students must learn how to manage knowledge collectively. Another skill essential for the younger generation is to learn how to use the latest technologies for aiding their learning process. Universities must create an ecosystem with adequate hardware and software where inspired teachers can be effectively used to propagate knowledge. Entrepreneurship is another quality which must be cultivated in our students from an early age. They must learn how to take calculated risks for the sake of greater achievements within the parameters of ethical business practices. Value-oriented education with deep understanding of the democratic governance structure and systems are a must for building leadership skills. Development of the country and betterment of humanity should be the guiding principles of mission-driven leaders of tomorrow. Yes, we can. Spirit also has to be inculcated in formative years of our Gen Next. They must have the disposition to do the right thing as well as to do things right. Friends, urgent measures to improve academic management in higher level institutions are necessary to make learning more effective. Teaching pedagogy must be refined, curricula updated regularly, and interdisciplinary approach adopted and evaluation mechanism reformed. They must identify core competencies and nurture centers of excellence. The higher education sector is witnessing sweeping changes the world over. Rising costs of higher education and the changing profiles of education seekers, aided by technological innovation, are leading to alternative models of knowledge dissemination. MOOCs, which first began in 2008, allow students to hear lectures and read course materials online and earn a degree at a cost much lower than conventional education. Disruptive technologies should be used to our advantage. Friends, is it possible to become a world power without a single world-class university? In two reputed international rankings of universities, there is not a single entry from India against the top 200 places. I refuse to believe that despite having the second largest higher education system in the world, with over 700 universities and 36,000 colleges, we do not have even one truly outstanding institution. The fault lies in our casual approach. The rankings process should be taken seriously. A high rank can boost the morale of the academic community, and even greater avenues of growth and placements for students. It can help attract the best faculty from India and abroad, and provide a benchmark for continuous quality enhancement. Concrete action to present the credentials of our institution is needed. Institutions must set up nodal authorities to handle data coordination. Some of the IITs have developed expertise in dealing with the ratings process. They can act as knowledge partners to other institutions. As a result of concerted efforts, India today has 9 institutions in top 50 in the BRICS region, with the Indian Institute of Science Bangalore at the 5th position. I congratulate them on this occasion. I hope the success in the BRICS rating will extend to other international ratings. Friends, our country is beset with problems like drinking water, sanitation, energy availability, urbanization, and poverty that call for innovative solutions. These challenges must ring the bells in the laboratories, corridors, and classrooms of our higher academic institutions. Unfortunately, research in most institutes is marked by a certain degree of neglect. The ecosystem for cutting-edge research is missing. The general apathy is reflected in some indicators. India has 160 researchers in research and development per 1 million people, compared to 710 in Brazil and 1,020 in China. In high technology exports also, India does not fare well. The Make in India campaign aims at facilitating investment, promoting innovation, fostering skill development, and establishing best-in-class manufacturing infrastructure. Our universities and engineering and research institutions must take up this challenge and make India a hub for technology-based products. They must build a research culture and promote research activity at all levels. Friends, our institutes of higher learning must leverage their linkages with key stakeholders. Academic institutions in India must develop partnerships with reputed international institutions. A win-win mode of interaction could be exchange of faculty, collaborative research, and sharing of academic resources like course materials and resource persons. An increased interaction by setting up industry interface, sales and induction of industry experts in governance structure of our institutes can pave the way for sponsorship of chairs, support for research projects, and setting up of incubation centers and laboratories. Alumni have an emotional connect with their alma mater. An institution can draw the expertise and experience of some of the last year's alumni for academic management through governing bodies. They can also be drafted for business and project mentoring and curriculum design. A higher educational institution has to interact with the society at large. Its soft power of persuasion and influence extend beyond its classrooms. Adoption of some neighborhood villages to effect holistic change and transform them into model villages can be a very good beginning. Before I conclude, there is a piece of advice from Mahatma Gandhi, which we do well to remember. I quote, "Literary education is of no value if it is not able to build up a sound character," unquote. I once again wish all of you a very happy and rewarding academic year ahead. Let the time be spent in fruitful pursuits, meaningful opportunities, and significant achievements. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for the patience.
Sir, on behalf of the academic community and on my personal behalf, I thank Your Excellency for your words of wisdom, vision, and encouragement. And sir, on behalf of the community, let me assure you that every single word that you have uttered will be taken up in utmost sincerity. Thank you very much, sir. Interaction and collective efforts are key to success in academic pursuits. May I now request Professor Rahul Pandit, IIC Bangalore, to kindly initiate the interaction session. Mr. Please.
Thank you. Honorable President, sir, it is a great honor and privilege to share with you some of the steps we have taken in our institute to energize higher education over the past decade. We have striven to improve research infrastructure by setting up central facilities in which researchers can use state-of-the-art equipment for their studies. Examples include the fabrication facilities in our Center for Nanoscience and Engineering and the petaflop computer in our Supercomputer Education and Research Center. We have improved our teaching classrooms so that our professors can use modern pedagogical techniques to train our 3,500 students, 2,200 of whom are in PhD programs. It is here and in our laboratories that we train tomorrow's professors today. On our new campus in Talakere, we are establishing big research facilities like one for solar thermal research. We have also set up a talent development center here to train teachers in high school and college levels. Many teachers have been trained here, and this activity is being strengthened now under the Pandit Madan Mohan Malaviya program of the Government of India. Internationalization is an important step in attaining a position of global leadership. This is handled by our Office of International Relations, and with this in mind, our institute invites several international scholars to our campus to lecture here and to take part in joint research programs. The numbers of international students is also increasing, and our institute also encourages faculty members and students to present their research results in international conferences to the extent possible within our resources. Our faculty members also interact closely with several industries, and like you said, also take part in incubating new companies. We have also made special efforts to make contact with our alumni. You have spoken, sir, about the important role of faculty members in effecting changes in our education system, Sir, we would be grateful if you could share with us what kind of teachers you envisage in this role. Thank you very much, sir, for giving us this opportunity to share our experiences with you.
Thank you, Professor Pandit. From South, may we now move to the Far East. May I request Dr. Swarnendu Kumar Chakravarti, a faculty colleague from NIT Arunachal Pradesh, to kindly share his experience from the Institute and raise a question, if any.
Good afternoon, President sir, and all of you. It is my great honor and privilege to share a small piece of experience with you. This is nothing but due to inspirational motivation and visionary innovations of our leadership. We all are here, have converted all difficulties, namely locational, socio-economic, logistic, etc., to a golden opportunities. That is how we are building our institute to be a global leader in higher technical education. Sir, our syllabus is full of entrepreneurship courses. Also, our campus is full of solar powered. Now, I humbly put a query to your honor. Sir, you have already talked about a superior ecosystem to reverse the research neglect in our institution. As a developing country like India, what should be the focus of our research activity? Can our research priorities be similar with those developed nations? And can that make us global leader? Thank you, sir. Thanks again for this opportunity given by you.
Thank you, Dr. Chakravarti. Having heard from two of our faculty colleagues, I think it's time we should listen to a young friend. So may I now request Ms. Priyanka Dogra, a student from ISAR Mohali, to express her views and concerns, if any. So Priyanka, please.
Honorable President of India, Director ISAR Mohali, and all my teachers and fellow students across the country. I am Priyanka Dogra, pursuing my doctoral research under the guidance of Dr. Samrat Mukhopadhyay at ISAR Mohali. Proteins are workhorses of life. In our body, proteins are synthesized as a linear polymer of amino acids. In order to carry out functions, they need to adopt a unique shape by the protein folding process. However, incorrect folding leads to a sticky state of the protein that forms aggregates termed as amyloids. Such amyloid aggregates are linked to neurological disorders such as Alzheimer's and Parkinson's disease, and they riddle the brain in the disease condition. Our laboratory uses a wide range of state-of-the-art techniques to understand the process of protein misfolding and aggregation. For our studies, we have used a model protein named ovalbumin, which is present in egg white, and we have created a laboratory condition in which ovalbumin misfolds. Using Raman spectroscopy, which was originally discovered by Sir C.V. Raman, we were able to delineate the protein structural transitions during the aggregation process. Also, using atomic force microscopy, we looked into their nanoscale features, which resemble donut-like structures. We know that cells are the basic structure and functional units of life and are invariably covered by membranes made of lipids. Therefore, to study the effect of these donut-like amyloids on cells, we have artificially created a lipid-based membrane in our laboratory and have observed that these donut-shaped nanostructures cause toxicity and damage by puncturing the membrane. These studies will provide an important clue to the cause of the disease and will allow scientists to design therapeutics against various neurological disorders. So I have a question to ask my fellow students. I was a BSMS student at ISAR Mohali. I could have gone abroad for my PhD, but I chose to stay here because this institute has state-of-the-art facilities, and my mentors, Dr. Samrat Mukhopadhyay and Dr. Mili Bhattacharya, are among the best in the field. So the question, my question is, why should our students go abroad for higher education if they can get the same quality training in India? Before closing, I would like to thank the Honorable President of India and others for providing me this wonderful opportunity to share my experiences. Thank you.
Thank you, Priyanka. Sir, you just heard the excellent level of research and development taking place at ISC Bangalore, the developmental work taking place at NIT Arunachal Pradesh, and a very spirited presentation from one of our young friends from ISAR Mohali about biological sciences. Sir, would you like to respond to any of the questions or views expressed by your colleagues?
Thank you very much. Unfortunately, because of connectivity, the other question could not be arranged from Central University, Kerala. But I'm glad that all three participants have not only made their observations, but put certain searching questions collectively to us to address it. And I particularly like to congratulate the last questionnaire, Priyanka Dogra, student IESR Mohali, and she has very correctly pointed out, and from where I will start, that yes, if we can create the facilities in the Indian institutions of higher learning, why people would go outside for higher education in the postgraduate, doctoral, and other higher level? I absolutely agree with this observation. Now the question is, how we can improve this situation? And what are the important components of improving this situation as per my assessment of the situation in which we are left today? If you have carefully listened to my observations, I would like to say that almost like a parrot, on every academic congregation I am talking on this particular topic, that why we cannot improve our standard. And as I mentioned, almost like parrot, I am equally happy to point out, which I have mentioned in my main observations, that there have been response. There has been response from our institutions of higher learning, as a result of which we have improved our positions in the ranking of BRICS region. And please remember, amongst the BRICS region, there is an important country, which is the second powerful economy in the world, that is China. And there our positions have improved, I have already mentioned in my main observations. To improve the situation, I must say that we must emphasize on having the inspired teachers. We need a special breed of teachers who can play a leading role in the transformation that I am talking of. I have earlier mentioned about inspired teachers. According to me, an inspired teacher is a value-oriented, mission-driven, self-motivated, and result-oriented individual. He works towards impacting the environment in a positive manner through his own action, as well as by imparting knowledge amongst the students to help them achieve their potential. An inspired teacher links the individual goals of the students to the societal and national goals. Such teachers appeal not only to the head but also the heart through words, action, and deeds. They inspire the students and elevate them to a higher level of performance and thinking. Now, on the second question of attracting the top class faculty members, we recognize that there is deficiency in the faculty availability in our higher institutions. we must attract talent to the academic profession. We must retain meritorious students in Indian institutions after their graduation, bright students after the graduation either join the various professional sectors, including corporate sectors, civil service, or etc., or move to foreign universities for higher studies. As per some estimates, about 2 lakh students every year go overseas for this purpose. We must make an honest assessment as to why are we unable to retain meritorious students. Some steps have already been taken in that past few years. One is engagement of experts from India and abroad, either as visiting or adjunct faculty, signing a memorandum of understandings between Indian institutions and foreign institutions for exchange of faculty and students and collaborative research. Third, inducting alumni in the governance mechanism. Fourth, using technology-based models like SWAM and MOOCs for education delivery. And finally, setting up industry interface cells for collaborative activity. Now also, to have more and more inspired teachers, we must ensure that teaching as a profession must receive the respect and recognition that it deserves. It must become intellectually stimulating and socially gratifying. It must also be financially rewarding. And we must have an environment that fosters creativity and recognizes merit. What strategy we adopt, be it collaborating with academic and research institutions in India and abroad, exchange of faculty, or linkages with industry for innovating projects, is a matter of detail. Yet, in pursuing such a strategy, we can place our institutions on a higher pedestal in terms of research and motivation. On the issue of research priorities, the focus of research has to be multifarious. On the one hand, our academic and research centers need to address the immediate problems faced by our country, like drinking water, sanitation, urbanization, clean rivers, poverty, and rural rejuvenation. On the other hand, they must pursue cutting-edge research in fundamental science and high technology areas. Our institutions must leverage their expertises and core competencies while undertaking research. Last, with all-round development, including focused attention on research and a proactive approach to the ranking process, as I mentioned already, some of our Indian institutions can easily come closer to the best in the world. I am sure very soon our institution would fulfill in a much bigger way the scholastic needs and professional expectations of our young minds. I am certain the youth of our country will soon have access to a world-class education system in their homeland. Thank you once again for your eager participation today. I look forward to interacting with you early next year. Thank you once again, ladies and gentlemen. Jai Hind.
Sir, we must thank you for your very comprehensive views on higher education. You, as the visitor to the institutes of higher learning, you have provided us the right guidance. And I must assure you that we are truly committed to live up to your expectation. But sir, I would also like to take this opportunity to mention that last year an independent agency did their survey and then projected the five older IITs together as the 61st institution in the world. And sir, this year another independent review by another journal rated IITs, the five older IITs, as only fourth in the world in terms of number of jobs created and entrepreneurship coming out of institutions, only after the Stanford University, MIT, and the University System of California. But I do agree, and on behalf of my colleagues and student friends, I certainly assure you that every single advice that you have spelled out today will be taken up in right earnestness, and we are very keen to prove ourselves among the best in the world and make the country and the nation proud. Sir, I also take this opportunity to thank profusely colleagues from Bangalore, Arunachal Pradesh, and Mohali who have taken part in interaction. And I'm told about 600 institutions are actually viewing this program through NKN. So I thank all of them also for joining this interaction session with our topmost guardian of higher education in India. Before we wind up the session, hoping similar opportunity of interaction with the visitor to the Institutes for Higher Learning in the near future, may I now invite Professor G.C. Tripathi, Vice Chancellor, Banaras Hindu University, to kindly propose the vote of thanks.
Namaskar and a very good afternoon to all of you. Honorable President of India, Shri Pranab Mukherjee, it's my proud privilege to offer a vote of thanks to you on behalf of all the participants in today's program. Sir, I on my own behalf and on behalf of all the participants express my sincere thanks and gratitude to you for your enlightening and thought-provoking address. In the knowledge-based society and knowledge economy, institutions of higher learning have to play a pivotal role in making India derive rich dividends from its knowledge capital. Your address today was inspiring and transformative. Sir, your innovative approach establishing a direct connect with the stakeholders of higher education has evinced a keen interest in the students and academics across the country who eagerly wait for this event. We salute your untiring efforts in making higher education in India regain its pristine glory, in which you see the future of India in this era of globalization and are overwhelmed by your concern for it. We also thank the entire team of Rashtrapati Bhavan, headed by Srimati Omita Paul, Secretary to the President, and the team of Ministry of Human Resource Development for organizing this event flawlessly. Our thanks are also due to the team of NIC and NKN to make this event happen by connecting the institutions across the length and breadth of the country, which by no means is an easy task. Last but not least, I would like to thank all the vice chancellors of the universities and directors of the institutes, their faculty members and students for their active and eager participation in the program. Now I request all the participants to rise for the national anthem. Thank you.